Good morning, Saints.
Good morning.
I'm going to introduce you, Matt. For a while. Well, welcome to you today. So good to see you, and a very warm welcome, especially to those we have not seen for a while, those who are sort of slowly returning, and to any visitors. Are there any visitors here this morning? There are. Oh, wow. I'm going to ask you to give a warm Emmanuel welcome to our visitors. Folks, if you're new, it's not what we do often, but we're going to do a series on giving as we do our pledge dedication next Sunday. So I think there should be letters for everybody as you consider your giving faithfully here to Emmanuel over the next coming year, and as you pray about it, it's going to be a wonderful occasion as we all come up here next Sunday and we make our dedication of ourselves and also of our giving faithfully and regularly. Let's pray. Gracious Father, thank you for this day, and we just thank you for all that you're doing in our lives in so many different ways. Thank you for the sense of celebration in this place. And we think of last weekend, Lord, with that high tea and just the fun we were having together. Thank you for so many opportunities in the coming weeks, even as we prepare for Advent and Christmas. And we pray that it would be a celebration of the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, our Savior Jesus. Amen. So bless this morning, Lord, we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
What a beautiful day it is today, isn't it? If there's anyone here who came here with a heavy heart this morning, or something happened during the week, and you didn't know what to do, just remember, God is in the house this morning. And He's here to see to each and every problem, every circumstance that we went through this morning, this week, He's here to solve it this morning.
Amen.
So you just have to open up and say, Lord, here am I. Everything I'll give to you. And you are everything to me. Because we serve the God that changes things. Just let us pray. Father, we thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you for being in the house this morning. Lord, you were here before we even put our foot into that door, Lord. You were here. Because you are here to bless us this morning. You are here to favor us this morning. You are here to hold us in your arms when you're feeling so weak and we don't know where to go to, Lord. You are here. And you are here to see to all of our problems, everything, Lord, we give to you this morning. We praise you, we glorify you. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. The name that we can call on to. The name that is above all other names, as you already declared. So come, Father God, and guide us this morning in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
How good and pleasant it is when brethren dwells together in unity. That's what God's word says in Psalm 133. We are the people joined by God's grace, and we are called to worship Him. And in Revelation chapter 5, the elders and living creatures all sang beautiful song and praise of glory unto Jesus. He is worthy to receive our praise. He is worthy to receive the wisdom and strength and honor. So we're going to stand this morning, and we're going to sing that beautiful song, Ancient of Days. is burning among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. What a beautiful name it is. You were in the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. God the praise that He deserves. Whatever God has laid on your heart this morning, just praise Him. Just give Him the glory that He deserves. Thank you, Jesus.
You are my friend. Yet you are my king.
Yes, Lord.
And I'm a princess.
Yes, I'm a little.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord, that you care so much for us. We want to bless your holy name, Lord. Yet we are not worthy, Lord.
Yes.
But we want to bless you and praise you and thank you for everything that you do for us.
Yes.
That you also fight for us.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord, for the blessings you bestow on our lives. And thank you that you're filling this church. Thank you, you are the King of us. King of kings is your name.
Yes.
Blessing and honor and power and glory is due your name, Lord. For you are the King of kings and the Lord of kings. There's no one like you, and no one more than you are your people. We thank you and we praise you for who you are. Father God, today is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice at you.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you for this day, Father God. Bless you, Father.
Thanks.
Thank you, Lord.
Father, we praise and thank you for the many things that we can give thanks for and are grateful for. Thank you for the gift of life, Lord. And thank you for the gift of new life in Jesus.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord, for forgiveness. Thank you for the gift of righteousness, which is not something we can earn or work for, but a gift given to us so freely. We worship you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Song, there's a verse that says, come to the Father, though your gift is small. Broken hearts, broken lives, you will take them all. Everything that we have belongs to the Father. He made it and He gave it to us. And if it is broken, who knows best how to fix it? Hallelujah. He made it so freely. He gave it to us. Before the world began, you were on His mind.
Because of His great love.
everything was done so you would come.
For the world began.
Before the world began, you were on his mind.
Anymore.
Bless you. prayer, prayer of surrender. Just say to the Lord, Lord, here I am, I want to hear, you've spoken to me. Remember, he's a God who's alive, he's not a God made of stone or wood or any other material. He's a God who's alive, and he's a God who loves to speak to his children, speak to his people, as he calls us to himself. Just where you are, just pray that prayer. Say, Lord, thank you that you love me and you've spoken to me. I just surrender myself to you. And even if you've done it before, do it again. Sometimes there are areas of our life that we take back. And you need to re-surrender your life to Christ. And just do that so that you can really be in the center of God's will for your life. Oh, the joy. Get rid of that frustration, that irritation, that prickliness, that unhappiness. Know that in the center of his world is the joy of the Lord.
Almighty God,
I pray, Father, your penitence we confess, that we have sinned against you through our own fault, in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have left undone. For the sake of your Son, Christ our Lord, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in the newness of life, to the glory of your name.
Psalmist reminds us that he has not dealt with us according to our sins, and rewarded us according to our wickedness. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he set our sins from us. Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and keep us in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We pray together the prayer for this week. God of all time, in Christ you make all things new. Grant us wisdom to interpret the signs of the times, courage to stand firm in the time of trial, and faith to witness your truth and love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
We said that baptism together.
I believe in the trust in God.
1 to 5. And now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. In the midst of a very severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For our testimony that they gave as much as they were able, and even beyond the ability. Entirely on their own, they urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in the service to the Lord's people. And they exceeded our expectations. They gave themselves first of all to the Lord, and then by the will of God, also to us. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gracious Father, thank you for your word once again read to us. We know that your word is sharper than any two-edged sword, that it cuts even to the dividing of bone and marrow. So, Lord, we thank you for your word. You also said that we cannot live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. And so we pray, Lord, help us to become people of the word. People who know your word, people who love your word, and people who put your word into practice. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So, as I said earlier on, we are preparing for next week, where we do our pledge dedication. I said it's always such a wonderful time when people do that. You know, I've been at many services where I've had altar calls, and you're lovely to see half a dozen people coming up and giving their lives to the Lord. But it's even more wonderful when you see an entire congregation coming forward and making that kind of dedication and the renewal of their giving to the church. And some might say, well, we don't really need a preaching series, you know, or any motivation. You know, we're motivated enough. Well, you will be surprised, particularly when we've gone through rough times, like over the last 2 years, we get sort of bumped around and we begin to question our priorities. And things begin to change, as you know. How many people do you know, people who are not in church this morning, but probably watching online? And some of them have made that decision that, you know, it's so much nicer sitting at home in my gown and my pajamas with my coffee and my donuts, if they manage to get out and get some donuts and so on. And so everybody's been challenged by these tough times that we've been in. It doesn't matter who you are, even people like the Pope. And if Mother Teresa was around, she would also be challenged by these tough times. Because you see, people get to the end of the year, they start thinking about budgeting for the next year. And Emmanuel, particularly, as they're thinking about appointing a new minister sometime next year, they, you know, you're going to be thinking about that. You know, how are we going to go forward? Story told about a convent who was going through the same process. So Mother Teresa decided that what she would do, she would not just do some thumb suck, as many church people do, but she's going to go meticulously through every area. And she was going to contact all of her suppliers to find out what their increase would be next year. That's why it's so important that we increase our giving. Because you see, inflation hits us all. And so she decided to phone all of these people. You know, you think of the fuel price, for example, keeps going up. You never know what's going to happen. I don't know how far she got with, you know, phoning the fuel company to find out what the petrol price would be the following year. But finally, she contacted Eskom, electricity suppliers, wanting to know, you know, are there going to be any sort of load shedding next year? What's it going to be? Finally, she spoke to someone there, and she asked the question, how much will the price of electricity go up next year? Deciding to break the news gently, the sales official asked, excuse me, mother, are you sitting down? Then there was a pause, and she replied, I'm kneeling down. But maybe that's got to be our posture too, as we think about giving. Because sometimes we look around and we're like, oh my gosh, how on earth are we going to do it? And many of us have grown up with different ways of giving. It's often not the biblical way, you see. So here are sort of five ways the way some people give. They say there's the dream level. The dream level is the person says, if only I was rich or a millionaire, I would sort out all the expenses of the church. Some of us are in that sort of dream level. Then there's the vague level. I will give what I can. You know, some people fall into that category. I will give what I can. And then there's the emotional level. I give when I feel like it, when my heart feels like it, and I moves by my heart. And lots of people in church who operate in that way as well. Then there's the entertainment level. I give when I go. And sometimes they might say, well, if it was a good show, I'd probably decide which one to give, the green one, or the brown one, or the blue one. And then there's the tip level. I'll take the smallest one of my purse and give that one. Now this, of course, folks, is not the biblical way of giving. Remember that our main reason for giving is to glorify God. We honor God through our tithes and our offerings. Always remember that, yes, it is about budgeting, but the main reason you give, the Bible says that we love Him because He first loved us. It's a response. Yeah, all of you have been in love, haven't you? I know some of us have had more disappointments than others, and so on. But you know, there's a principle called reciprocity, that when somebody shows you love, you get love in return. And so the same with us as well, that God has shown us his love in so many ways. That's why you see at the beginning, we give people an opportunity just to give thanks to God. And that's the one time when you're allowed to overhear other people's praise to God. And you hear what they say. This one saying, thank you for that. Thank you for salvation. Thank you for forgiveness. Thank you for my family. Thank you for this. Thank you for heaven. Thank you for the gift of righteousness. And the list goes on. Particularly for those of you who have been on health for life. Gosh, what a journey that has been, right? You're like, wow, this is amazing. God has poured out his Holy Spirit into our hearts. And it is like living sort of in another world, cloud 9 or 7th heaven, and so on. Just amazing. I love doing pastoral visits, and I go into people's homes every week, announced or unannounced. So watch out, I might just get to your place unannounced. So I went to visit one lady who's in her 90s this past week, and we talked about this. She was a happy lady, and I could see there's something different about that. You know, they say we often die the way we lived. If you live in misery, you're going to die in misery. But if you live joyful, happy, grateful, thankful, that's the way you could die. And without me even, pushing her, she said to me, do you know what my favorite is? Count your blessings, name them one by one. And she said to me, I count my blessings every day. I think that's a good way to start your day. Count your blessings, constantly remind yourself what God has done for you. He's done so much for each one of us, and the list goes on and on. You know the great man John Newton, who wrote that famous song, Amazing Grace, wonderful song, one of the many hundreds of songs which I once sung at my funeral. You know, he had above his mantelpiece the following words, folks, and this is so important. Obviously written in that sort of old language, he says, thou shalt remember that thou was a bondsman in the land of Egypt, and the Lord thy God redeemed thee. Wow. Do you know what one of my favorite verses is? It comes from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. Your grace is sufficient. Mm-hmm. On one of my birthdays, because I've learned the importance of generosity, I gave every person who was there a bookmark with those words in them. And I want people to remember, that's it. I know I'm not where I am, even being dragged out of retirement because of my own ability, because I've got a mountain bike column. But because of his grace. His grace is sufficient. His grace has carried me from the first day I gave my life to Jesus, and he will continue to carry me. Amen. And that's what we're all going to be. I wake up with that, and I've got one of them sort of, my little corner where I'm allowed to sort of pray and read and do all kinds of things, and so on, to remind me constantly, his grace is sufficient. And you see, what it does inside of me, folks, even when you have a bad day, you look to him and not your circumstances. And that is such an important principle, folks. You all are going to face different things, even as you draw towards the close of the year. Thinking of our young people, for example, every year is a different year, whether you're going on to another grade, or you finish the trip, you're going on to studies, or to work, or whatever. It's always important to keep your eyes on him. His grace is sufficient. Paul had founded this church, the Corinthians church, that we had a little passage read from this morning from chapter 8. And he was always concerned about this church, that they would grow in the things of God, in their spiritual life. And of course, he had taught them many things. We've never had a chance to read through the entire two letters which we have there. Do that. Because he touches on so many subjects which are not discussed in any of his other letters. But there was one area, even there, they have grown in so many areas. Maybe look at the spiritual gifts, only talked about in the letters to the Corinthians. But there was one thing that they struggled with. It's the area of their giving. The area of their giving. And you know, he makes those famous, that famous statement in 2 Corinthians 9 verse 7. He says, God loves a cheerful giver. And the question is always, how do you get a person from being a miserable giver to make them a cheerful giver? Not very easy, okay? I know, even some couples have got very upset when they discover that suddenly the wife is moved to start tithing, like, oh my word. And they have to come from marriage counseling to sort that one out because you're like on two different levels. But you do. But what can you do when you get to a place where you become a cheerful giver and suddenly you start sort of getting so excited about it? And you can't wait for the sermon to be over so that you can put your money in the offering bag. Can you imagine? Shorter sermon, not because I don't want to hear more what you preach, but so I can get to the offering thing. I mean, can you imagine? Because you see, that word in the Greek is where we get our word hilarious from. Wow! See, God loves hilarious people. We get, and we will get to that place. So he begins and he writes to them and he says, my brothers and sisters, we want you to know what the grace of God has accomplished in the Macedonians. You know, it's always great to be encouraged, motivated by other Christians. I always watch what other people do. And I look at them and I'm really excited. I want to be excited as that. You know, I look at this like Alice and I said, no, I want to be holy like Alice. You know, or so on. There are so many other people, you know, people I've known for so many years, Gerald and Trevor and these guys and so on. You know, they only look at me, but I look at them as well. These guys all become a sort of source of encouragement. You've got to. And so you find somebody who knows how to give. Get them alongside them because they say the rubs off on you. Okay? Remember that's something about faith. If you forget everything this morning, remember this one thing. Faith is not taught, it is caught. Okay? It's like a sickness. And that's why if you want to pick up somebody else's germs, get close to them. And the same principle is true spiritually. If you want to pick up somebody else's spirituality, get close to them. So I once had an assistant who worked with me. They don't often give me assistance because they're afraid I might make them as crazy as I am. And she used to often say when she was given an opportunity to preach, stick closer to the pastor and you'll grow faster. So, you know, it's interesting. He uses the word grace when he talks about giving. He says, we want you to know what the grace of God has accomplished in the Macedonians. You see, grace is something that we receive. Okay, another word for grace is gratis, free of charge. What he has accomplished in the Macedonians, and he's going to get to the whole area of giving as he uses the word grace. Because grace is something that we receive from God, but grace is always also something that we give to others. And that's why Stuart Yancey has written his book, we've got to be grace givers. And we do that through our giving. And so Paul goes on and he talks about four areas which I want you to underline the way the Macedonians gave. The first is they gave though they were poor. So there must have been a poorer congregation than the Corinthians. And he says to them in verse 2 of that chapter 8, he says, in the midst of a very severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty wound up in rich generosity. I often often say to people when they say to me, you mustn't preach about giving amongst poor people. And I say, never allow poverty to become an excuse for not giving. Never, never, never. One of the places where Jesus loved to sit, he didn't sit on the left or the right or the front. He sat at the offering bowl. They'd have it there at the church as people came in. And you'd sit. Interesting. Can you imagine? We're having, you have to put your offerings over there. And my job is to sit in the offering bowl to see how you give. So, of course, the disciples were so impressed as they watched all these people put their bags of money in. Love the Good News Bible. If you haven't seen the Good News Bible, they show the heavy bags of money they're putting. And then they show this little widow, and she comes in and she puts in two little coins. And you can imagine, you know, when you see somebody putting in just a little, you're like, okay, pretend I haven't seen that. But Jesus draws the attention to it and he says, wait, tell me something to teach you. This woman, poor as she is, she has given more than all these other people because they're given out of the abundance that she's given everything. You see, there's a lesson in that, and it's often you see poor people, it's often people, even more pensioners, who give so freely and set such an example and a challenge to each one of us. Never ever allow poverty to become an excuse for not giving. The second thing he points out, he says, they gave beyond their ability. Verse 3 says, for I testify that they gave as much as they were able and even beyond their ability. The friend was here and he was talking about giving until it hurts. Maybe that's what they were talking about here. They gave beyond their ability. The masters gave beyond their tithe, beyond their offerings. They gave sacrificially. And our giving should cost us something as well. Jesus' giving cost him his life, everything. And our giving should be the same. Thirdly, they understood the principle of sowing and reaping, and they begged. Can you imagine? You say to somebody, well, you don't have to give. And the person comes and they beg you. Why is it? What is it that they understood? That they begged to be part of the giving. The Bible says here, they urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing. There's an inescapable principle built into our world, both in the physical world and the spiritual world. You reap what you sow. Okay? Now, if you don't sow, don't expect to reap. Can you imagine a farmer there in Malmesbury and he's just sitting there watching his fields and hoping for the best? And when, you know, reaping times come, he goes out with his tractors and he's all shocked. How come there's nothing here? And the farmer next door says to him, well, is there something wrong with you? You cannot reap if you haven't sown. Now, let me tell you how crazy I am believing this. So one day, at church, won't tell you which church, and you will really find out how crazy I am. So I said to them, how many of you here haven't got any offering? There were about five people who put their hands up. So I said, okay, well, those of you who've got extra, why don't you give it to those people who don't have it? See, that's why these people write letters and they tell the bishop, this guy's lost it. She said, don't, few people will think of that, but you see, I believe in it because I want everybody to sow so that they can reap. So last week I was at the service, and so the offering time came, and I said to the Lord, there will be some people there who didn't bring an offering. I want them to sow. So I turned around, and behind me sat a bunch of young people, mainly girls. And I thought, wouldn't that be great? Wouldn't it be such a good idea to give the girls some money? I just get the wrong idea. So I saw amongst them a chap who looked like Down Syndrome tuna guy. And I took the money out and I gave it to him. I said, this is your offering. But at first he sort of recovered from his shock, and then he got up. And then he walked towards the front to the offering basket or whatever it was. And I could see people watching him thinking that either he had lost it, or he might just be trying to take something out of it, and he popped it in. You see, I get excited at that because I know, because he's sown, he's going to reap. And I'm going to rejoice. And people won't even know where it's come from. They're like, where did this guy get that from? How come he's being so blessed? And you see, it's going to have repercussions both on his life and the lives of others too, because they will learn the principle of sowing and reaping. It is a principle, folk, that's written, as I will repeat to you again, both in our physical and our spiritual world. You sow what you reap. It's true even with our words. If you sow gossiping, if you sow destructiveness, if you sow bad things, remember, that's what you're going to reap. And the same is true with money and anything else. Finally, the Bible says they gave themselves. That's why surrender is so important. And so when we come up, you see, I don't want you just to rush up to the altar. I want you just to stand here next week and just for a moment pray a prayer, say, God, I give you myself. And you know, as you give yourself, I want you to give also those areas that are not so great. Because you see, what we often do, we hold on to the areas which we think, oh, God's not really interested in my son or daughters who are a bit wayward and on drugs and so on. Give that as well. Give that as well. Because you see, by you holding on to it, it's not going to make the situation better. But it's by giving it to him that it will transform the situation. And we've got to learn that. I learned that from John Peacock, really in my spiritual walk as well. He says, he tells the story about a woman he was counseling, and they had banned, they had separated. And so he said to her, how do you see your sort of ex-husband? Says, oh, I see in the arms of this other woman, and that makes me mad. He says, don't see it in that way. Give that to God. And see how it will transform the situation. And they exceeded our expectations. They gave themselves first to the Lord, and then by the will of God, also to us. Let's do that, folks. I can promise you, I put my head in a rock, I can believe in it, and I want every person is struggling even financially to get to that point where you learn the principle of sowing and reaping. Surrendering to God and know the difference that he can make. I want you to be so blessed out of your socks, even if they're pretty colorful socks. You know, because that's what God wants to do. But you see, so often we get to a place, even folks who've been in a wonderful thing like Alpha, they go, and they go through the experience, but they don't put certain principles into practice. And that I've been there, done that, five times over. Yeah, but did you learn to put into practice some of these spiritual principles? Did you grow, or are you the same person that you were when you started? It's all about, and it begins with surrender. God bless you. Let's just be quiet. I just have a sense that we're going to do that. And again, I want to give you an opportunity. I know that a number of you I've done that, but maybe there's one person here today who never really surrendered. And you know, it's a simple prayer to pray, because he's been standing at that door knocking. And all you've got to do is open that door and let him in. Just say to him, Lord Jesus, today I thank you for your love for me. Thank you that you gave your life for me. I give my life to you. I surrender to you. I ask you to come in as my Lord and my Savior. Thank you in Jesus' name. And if you've prayed that prayer, do tell me afterwards, as we come to an end, and we're going to continue in prayers. Thanks very much. Come.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father and gracious God, we come before you this morning to give you all honor, all the praise, and all the glory, Lord. Lord, today, I just want to pray for our church, Lord. Pray that we come together, band together as one, to glorify your name. We pray that we, as sons and daughters of the Most High, give freely, not just of our labor, but of ourselves. If any of my brothers and sisters are in need, let us give and help together. A listening ear, an encouraging word, a heart, but most of all, and most importantly, give a prayer. Pray that we stand in the gap for one another and lift each other up. In your mercy, Lord. Lord, let us also be thankful for what we have and not focus on what we don't have. Teach us to give with grateful hearts, Lord. Lord, we know so many people that don't have. And we sometimes just scoff at the stuff that we do have, and those people pray for what we have. Let us be with grateful hearts for what we have and do with what we have. We pray for the youth who is busy with the final exams. We pray that you give them a clear mind and a calm mind, Lord. We bind every spirit of fear and anxiety in Jesus' mighty name. We speak peace over their love, over their lives, of the living God over them, to cover them in your precious blood. We pray for the sick, frail, and elderly, Lord. Give them a touch of your healing power, Lord. We pray that those who have not yet been given, that not yet has given their life to Christ, that they will come to you, Jesus Christ, that they will have an encounter with you, and that you will turn their lives around, Lord. Cover them in the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray for all of this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Good, thanks, Colin. Let's stand for the peace. And just thought this sentence is appropriate as we think about bringing our gifts to the altar. If when you bring your gift to the altar, you remember that someone has a grievance against you, leave your gift where it is before the altar, go make peace, and only then come and offer your gift. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you. Thank you.
yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, the majesty. For everything in heaven and earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you. Lord, bless us and bless these gifts for your glory and honor, for the extension of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, it is our duty and our joy at all times and all places to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. For he is your living word, through him we have created all things from the beginning and formed us in your own image. Through him you have freed us from the slavery of sin, giving him to be born as man, to die on the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. Through him you have sent us on your holy and life-giving spirit, and made us a people for your own possession. Today we give you thanks, because you have gathered us together at this Eucharistic feast, so that we may be renewed in faith, hope, and love. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, where we praise you and say, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God, our and light, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And as we follow his example and obey his command, granted by the power of the Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood. With the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. And so we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ the Lord come again. Therefore, Heavenly Father, we demand his offering of himself paid once for all upon the cross, and proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. As we look for his coming in glory, we celebrate with his bread and his cup, his one perfect sacrifice. Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts, in the presence of your divine majesty, renew our spiritual spirit, inspire us with your love, unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, by the power of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. We sit and kneel to pray. As Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. The bread which we break, is it not a sharing of the body of Christ?
We are in our own body, for we all take the
Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, forgive us our sins, have mercy on us.
Jesus, Redeemer of the world, give us your peace.
So draw near and receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you, feed on it in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. Please indicate to the lay minister if you prefer grape juice to wine. come together and we give thanks to God once again for the joy and the privilege to gather together in this place with the people of God, to be fed by His Word, by the sacraments, through the worship and so many aspects of this service. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is gracious. We pray together. Father Almighty, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice in Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out into the world in the power of the Holy Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Any special praise for birthdays and anniversaries? Elizabeth's contract has been extended, so give thanks to God for that. And a birthday tomorrow. It's her birthday today. Okay. Let's continue to pray for Elsie B. There's some progress there taking place. And so we just thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for healing. And we just thank you, Lord, for what's happening in Elsie's life right now, and we ask your blessing. We continue to speak healing into her life, Lord, that that clock will be removed completely in the name of Jesus, and we trust you for complete healing in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord, we thank you for Elizabeth. Thank you for your faithfulness, and thank you for all that you have supplied in her life. Thank you for the shining light that she is, Lord, and I pray continue to bless her as we supply this need, Lord, and for this job, this contract that has been extended. And Lord, for Brother Basil, we thank you for him, Lord. Thank you for his faithfulness, and thank you all that you are doing in his life as he celebrates his birthday. We pray, Lord, your blessing upon him. Bless him and watch over him. Make your face shine upon him and be gracious to him. Look kindly upon him and may he know your shalom peace, Lord. Nothing missing, nothing broken. And we pray, Lord, for good health in every area of his life. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Great. Notice this scripture. Graham.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So just a couple of notices. The high tea that we had last week, we had such a lovely time. Even though I didn't have any tea. I had a piece of cake in the background over there. But we raised an amazing amount of 15,700. So I just want to thank all our donors, folks that have given their cake and tea and their time especially. It was an amazing time. So thank you everyone for giving what you have given towards the high tea. Then on the 20th, as Reg was mentioning, next week's service, dedication of our pledges. And there are envelopes at the back in the foyer as you leave this morning. With your name on, your pledge card, we want you to have your pledge card so that you can bring it and put it on the altar next week. If you do not, if there isn't an envelope, your name is not there, please speak to Karenza. That's Karenza on the side over there for those that don't know. If you need an envelope, if you need a card, speak to her. We don't want you to miss out on what he was preaching this morning about sowing and reaping. Then on the 26th of November, it's a Saturday, we are having an events planning meeting at 10 a.m. here in the hall. And every member of or leader of a group, whatever organization you are leading, if you are representing an organization, please be there on the on Saturday, the 26th of November. Even if you have an idea of where we can go with our church, some plan, please come along on the 26th of November. Then, of course, Children's Church Tres Rios on the same night, and then, of course, the night is also the movie night. So it's a busy day. Movie night, 50 rand is going to get you into the movies, plus a goodie bag. Tickets are available from a couple of the folk around, but you can speak to Melanie over there. She has all tickets available. Please get your ticket. Just remember, limited seats, and you guys want to sit in the back row? No kissing, no? Okay. And then, of course, on the 27th of November is the commissioning of our pastor and the wardens, and then also the Children's Church Christmas play on that Sunday morning. So it's a full morning that day, so do not miss out. Next week, our dedication of our pledges. You cannot miss that one. We all need to be here, and the folk that are not here also need to be here, because we do need to reap what we sow, and we want to show that we are cheerful givers. And then, of course, the 27th of November, commissioning of the pastor. So don't miss out. Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone.
Right. Now it's my job to convey some sad news. And I'm not going to use the word resignation. I'm going to use the word moving on. And that is Ryan and the Dean will be moving on from Emmanuel. And I've tested his heart, and I know it's not because he's upset with you, but God has something special in store for them. And we'll have an opportunity. I know it's all come so quickly because he's taking leave in December and so on. And so we'll have to use the 27th as a bit of a, make it a bigger party that's going to be. And we'll have an adult jumping castle as well. Okay, but you know, in the short time that I've known you, I just want to say thank you to God for you. And give thanks and pray his blessing on this new and exciting adventure. I know it is, I'm not going to, maybe I should tell them, you know, that they're opening up this big complex down the road in Kirstenhof, and they need a man with this man's skills, and I guess also from the Dean, you know, and so on. And I just feel it right. It's our sadness, but it's their joy and their blessing, and we want to keep you guys in prayer. Okay? So let's just raise our hands as we pray for them. Yes. And, Father, we want to thank you for these two young people. Thank you for all that they have poured into Emmanuel over the last 6 years or so. And thank you particularly during this lockdown time, Lord, where it's been tough and challenging. Thank you for all that they've given to Mel. And we want to ask for blessing and protection over them, Lord, as they walk in obedience to your will for their life. Will you continue to unfold your plans and your purposes for them, Lord? And we pray for that church which you're a plant from this parish. And we pray that there the kingdom will continue to be extended, and we'll see great things happening there as they use the gifts that you've given to both Ryan and Dean. We bless them in the name of Jesus. Amen. Okay, so let's continue. For a big speaker's blessing over Africa, and particularly our own country. God bless Africa, protect our children, transform our leaders, heal our communities, restore our dignity, and give us peace, for Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. And the peace and of his Son Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
We stand as we sing our closing song together. Great is thy faithfulness. Come in peace, and I will serve the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah.